Soy loco por ti, América. Soy loco por ti de amores. Soy loco por ti, América. Loco por ti de amores. Soy loco por ti, América. Soy loco por ti de amores. Soy loco por ti, América. Loco por ti de amores.
As you know, we are living difficult times. We've already gone through difficult economic situations in some countries of ours. We also have political issues. And on top of this, now we have this pandemic, a health crisis. So it deepened the difficulties we already had in several countries of ours. And everyone is suffering in one way or another, with more or less intensity, but we are all feeling the effects of this pandemic. It has definitely started on a clear date, but we don't have an end date, and we don't know how it will end. So there's a series of factors to consider. And with that, we have to try and look into the future now. Try to see what will happen in the agriculture sector, such an extremely important sector that gives us livelihoods and food for all, and where we should have no problems with production, distribution, and exports for those who have to those who don't have. We can't see that disrupted. Considering that, the Inter-American Institute for Cooperation on Agriculture, AICA, has decided to hold several sessions to analyze this time, this moment, and to anticipate the future, and specifically looking at food security for countries in our region. Today, we will focus on the southern part of the hemisphere: Brazil, Argentina, Uruguay, Paraguay, Chile, Bolivia, all this area. As I see it, we have basically two agricultures in this region. One that is doing great, record production, record prices, record exports, and going very well because they're very well valued products, beef and grains. But there's another agriculture that is not as prosperous: the small producers, the small agriculture. And they're the ones that have suffered with the pandemic. These small producers of fruit, flowers, dairy, they don't necessarily find the inputs to produce, and they have problems placing their products in internal markets. And also thinking about the fact that they're not necessarily exporters of these products. So trying to see what's coming next, what is the future that awaits us in such an important sector of trying to bring food to the table regionally and even in other areas, because we're also exporters, large exporters. So we want to talk about this. I am Mauro Zafalon. I'm a journalist from Sao Paulo. I live here in Sao Paulo. And I will be having a conversation with two agricultural engineers, specialists in their sector, two great personalities that are much focused on agribusiness for many years, that also have experience in internal policies of their countries, and also with the external vision of having worked in very large international organizations and multilateral organizations. We have Mr. Martin Pinheiro from Argentina and Roberto Rodriguez from Brazil. So, for our conversation, Martin, I'd like you to share your thoughts for 10 minutes. What's your assessment of the time we're living? What can we do to ensure food security, thinking about this situation? And then I would ask Roberto to do the same, how he sees it and the particular situations. And then afterwards, we open it up for some questions and dialogue so that we can better understand the difficulties we are living and that we probably will continue to have. So go ahead, Martin. The floor is yours. Thank you very much, Mauro, and good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to participate in this webinar, as they are called now. Good morning, Roberto. We had seen each other recently. As Mauro said, this is a very important crisis, not just from the health point of view, with all the consequences it has in itself, and looking at how many people have died, but it is also having quite a serious impact in economic terms, and I'm sure we will be discussing that as well. The economic perspectives in the situation, and of course, that related to food security. From the global economic standpoint, this is probably the most important crisis since the Second World War. As you know, the World Bank and the Fund have estimated that the GDP will fall about 5% worldwide, and that decrease will be more significant in Latin America at about 7%. This is a tremendous drop. And of course, it affects agriculture and food security. I also have to say something that might not be directly related to the main topic of the seminar, but what will happen in the future, the world after COVID, after this pandemic? Will it be the same or will it be a new, different world? It's an important dialogue that's happening now. I tend to believe that the world will be more or less the same. There are some trends that we had seen before that will be sharper or things that will happen faster. But in the end, especially if there is a solution, a health solution with a vaccine or something similar, the world will probably come back to some kind of a balance as similar to what we have now. Now, let me comment. In Latin America, we have seen an aggravation of hunger. It has become more of a problem. But it's not so much an issue of production, because if you look at the figures for production and exports for our two countries, but for all of Latin America also, there has not been a substantial change there. There has been a negative effect in some perishable products because they depend a lot on migrant labor. Or for those that have very complex commercialization chains, so logistics has a clear impact on them. So for those, there have been some problems internationally as well. In the international market, some countries have added restrictions to products. And given the fall of oil prices, biofuel, for example, is not being sold. This is very important for Brazil and also significant for Argentina. So from the productive point of view, agriculture has withstood these problems of the pandemic quite well. Hunger is a consequence of more poverty, mainly in the urban areas. People that had a job that were not fixed employees or working full-time at a company, but were more informal, as we call them. That sector in Argentina is about 30% or maybe 40% of the population. And these people have seen a very sharp decrease in their income. All countries in Latin America have established policies to counter this, specific contributions and other types of aid. In Argentina, this has been very important, but it's not enough in any case. That sector of the population, informal workers, have seen great difficulties because they have less income and they are not being able to feed themselves. So as I said before, agriculture is resisting the negative effects of the pandemic relatively well. So it will be in a good condition to be one of the productive sectors that can restart more quickly, even if there is not any type of aid from government. And this will probably be the case because governments will have great economic difficulties. So that capacity to recover will also be related to the demand worldwide. But we've seen that the last thing to be sacrificed is food. So as the global economy starts growing, global demand will also stabilize. So there's great opportunities for the agricultural sector. With the correct policies, it can actually be one of the drivers for worldwide economic recovery, and that means, of course, each one of our countries as well. Thank you. Thank you so much, Martin. That was very interesting to hear that agriculture might actually be a sector that is not so hard hit. But, of course, it's worrying to know that there's more hunger in our cities. And the growing unemployment rates, the drop in GDP rates, these will probably be something that also affects agriculture as well. So thank you. And now, Roberto, could you give us your thoughts, please?
Okay.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Ika, for the opportunity. It's a great pleasure to be here with my great old friend, Martin Pinheiro, great leader. We're both from the same lifestyle of agriculture. And Mauro, thank you for being here with us as well, a colleague in Agro Brasileiro. I agree with everything that Mr. Pinheiro said, and I'd like to add something more from the point of view of Brazil, nationally speaking. What's clear in this pandemic is that food security has acquired a much more important place than it had before. And that's actually interesting. It's curious because, of course, this also was important in the post-war Europe, where they created the group to avoid hunger in the world. So after a while, there was no more hunger, and so they forgot about that topic of food security. But now it recovers a new dimension. And the same that happened to food security is happening to agriculture. People worldwide, consumers, cities, in cities and elsewhere, all recognize agriculture as a fundamental sector for the economy. And they also appreciate it. They are grateful for what rural producers have done in the region and in the world to continue the supply of food and to ensure food security. That in itself, I think, is important to communicate. Mauro, you are the specialist in communication, and this is important to understand. It's now being acknowledged in a better place by consumers. Even something that might be very obvious for us, that the sector, of course, can never stop because nature rules us. Nature tells us when to plant, when to sow. So we can never stop. We know that. So supply chains cannot stop either. They have to be close to us as producers. So the first thing is that the better situation or the good valuation of the sector in the world. Now, this might also have some potential consequences. One is, as Martin said, that governments in the whole world will once again support agriculture in their countries. Not because producers are somehow nicer now with the pandemic, but because food security has a new importance today, much stronger than before. Supporting agriculture means to ensure your supply. It's not just taking care of agriculture for its sake, but because you want to ensure your supply. So that type of support can bring two different actions with it. And these might complicate world trade in food. One is protectionism. Protectionism to local agriculture producers or farmers so that they defend their own local production. That might lead to difficulties in having more open markets. And the other is that many countries are already talking about prohibiting exports of surplus before they guarantee internal supply. So these two points could come and disrupt worldwide food trade. So producer countries like us in the South have to be very attentive to these opportunities. And we have to also understand the potential risks that may come with a pandemic. But I do believe it's essential to say this. Food security, quality of our food and agriculture have all acquired a new status and a new level worldwide. As a consequence as well, is that there are some new demands on governments and on the private sector. For governments, if there's that risk of market complications, although, as Martin said, demand is growing worldwide, diplomacy will be fundamental. Diplomatic agreements, multilateral, bilateral agreements, always focusing under the guidance of the WTO. In our region particularly, we cannot forget any market, whether it's Asia, America, Europe, Middle East or Africa. Wherever we have a demand or wherever there is a demand, we should be ready to supply. So with very open diplomacy, very democratic diplomacy. Then there's also the technological side. Martin already mentioned this as well when he mentioned connectivity and digitalization. This had already been seen before. It was happening slowly. But now with this pandemic, it has changed a bit of the fact that people are now working at home, not at the office. So connectivity for agriculture will also have a stronger presence than before the pandemic. That in itself implies government action as well to ensure this connectivity throughout the regions of a country. Something else that's essential is that the pandemic, such a long situation as well, this has shown that we are not well prepared. Also in the WHO, the World Health Organization, has lost a bit of its respect, if you will, globally speaking. So the issue of health and healthcare will have to also grow somehow. There's more concern for that worldwide. And in each country, there will be greater demands on health. Consumers will be more demanding. And in the end as well, more profound changes. Sustainability will certainly become more important than before. With the concept itself of sustainability, It covers the economy, the social side, the environmental side, the economic disaster we heard from Martin that is already happening in our countries. There will be social consequences as well, and these will be drastic. Unemployment, companies that are closing, many of these will not come back to the market. So we will have precarious social conditions in the near future, and the governments have to look at this very closely. So, serious problems socially, economically, companies shutting down, and then environmentally, health has an essential role to play in this new vision of sustainability that the world will demand. And this is in the very near future. So that's what I believe. There's a new respect for agriculture, but it could lead to protectionist policies that complicate world trade scenarios. So there, the importance of diplomacy to ensure arrangements and agreements that allow our countries to continue being the great producers of the world, and investment in technology of all types, but with a great emphasis on digitalization and connectivity. And looking at healthcare as an essential part of sustainability, I believe these are the very important topics for the short-term future. There's others that are quite related. One of these is a change in dietary habits. What will happen with what we eat and how we eat? There's already people that eat veggie burgers. This is something that will remain. Do we believe it will change? We have to try and analyze this trend to see whether these habits will change and to see that our producers can adapt to that if they do change. And lastly, there's the issue of bioeconomy. It is also related to this new sustainability. The bioeconomy also has a new importance today in the world and for our countries. We cannot let this happen without being part of that. Thank you. Thank you for your thoughts, Mr. Pinheiro, Mr. Rodriguez. I'd like to ask you some questions now. Starting with Martin. What do you consider is the importance of institutions like GAECA at this moment to do these types of meetings, to organize ways to transfer new technologies and good practices among different countries? So that anyone who has an experience in this area can share it with others. Well, I think that obviously technology transfer, especially for small farmers and producers, is first of all a responsibility of government in each of the countries. They're the ones that can have direct contact with small producers because there's so many in each of our countries. What institutions like GAECA can do and is actually doing is promoting this type of exchange of new technologies, sharing new information that we have worldwide and regionally, to bring that to the countries and to different organizations in the countries that have the responsibility to disseminate that technology. There's recently been a conference with a Nobel Prize winner, a Nobel Prize for Economy, on work that was done mainly in East Africa, demonstrating the great impact of technologies that can be shared through digital means, and how this can be done more efficiently and effectively, even cost-effectively. It has interesting results that show us the new opportunities we have from digitalization and new technologies. That's already being used in Argentina over here with small and medium-sized producers, mainly with larger ones, but also with small producers using communications networks and information networks. I think that is a good area for AICA to work. They're already doing it, and they can certainly expand and deepen that help. Thank you, Mr. Rodriguez. Thinking about what Martin has said, I know this is something you've always worked on in your life. Do you think the world should be more cooperative now, more international cooperation to ensure that exchange of food and communication and technology? There will be two effects. The pandemic has shown the importance of collaboration worldwide in health issues. We've seen the need or the inevitable connection that we have worldwide, how important it is to have cooperation and solidarity. But particularly for agriculture, there's that trend or tendency towards more protectionism and isolation. I think that will be only in the short term. It won't last long. But in every industry, we will see a shortening of global value chains and a re-emergence of regional integration and relations. And there's a great possibility for more trade within Latin America. Agricultural trade right now in the region is very small because of the logistics difficulties. So there should be policies to facilitate trade, to boost regional confidence and strengthen regional mechanisms for integration. It's an important area of work for our governments and AICA in support of governments. Thank you, Martín. Mr. Rodriguez, how should that cooperation be between the large producers and those that depend on food? We have cases of large producers, the area of the Caribbean that has more dependence on imports. So do you think we could have a better exchange? Yes, as Martin has said, I have my doubts, commercially speaking. Every country will try to find their own food security first and quality of food. That's the type of neo-protectionism we could see. And in a way, for trade, it won't be friendly or open to trade. It will defend itself. But in other areas, yes, of course, there will be cooperation. As Mr. Pinheiro said, for health issues, but then also technology. Because the demand for food will grow, especially if we see how population grows in Africa and Asia, and also their income per capita, demand will grow. And so there will be more production that will lead to better cooperation, technologically speaking, and integrating best cultural practices and best agricultural practices, sorry. We also have to see what type of agriculture we're talking about. We have our tropical agriculture that's different from the northern hemisphere where there's more temperate climates. The types of harvesting is different, the climate requirements and demands are different. So it's very clear that technological cooperation will be much more important, much more south-south than south-north for even the weather and climatic issues. So cooperation in trade will not be very clear or successful. Everyone will be looking out for themselves, but technologically, yes. And with health, of course, it will be essential worldwide. Thank you. So as you've explained, there will be some issues with international trade. Do you think we would see a situation of trade barriers coming? And do you think these could continue? As you said, some countries might even prohibit exports or imports, and affecting different issues in trade. How do you see that happen now? We probably will see more trades, non-tariff barriers, environmental or social barriers, to create difficulty for some countries. I think that will happen. But to compensate for that, it's very possible that we have many more bilateral agreements or multilateral agreements to try and boost trade among countries and also ensure food security. So that will be a key issue. In the beginning, post-pandemic, we will probably have a new kind of protectionism with barriers, as you said. But over time, I'm sure that demand will grow, and so we will need much more effective agreements. So that's why I said that diplomacy will have such an important role. It will be extraordinarily important in any new models that we find in agriculture. Diplomacy for agriculture. We cannot allow a country having this prejudice against another country. We have to be very open and ready to have diplomatic agreements that help us find more intra-regional and infra-regional trade. Thank you. Martin, you said that agriculture will probably suffer less than other sectors. The Minister of Economy of Argentina has said that we will see a shock in supply and a shock in demand, an impact on both of them. Can we say that won't happen to agriculture? Will it be outside of these? There will be no impact on supply or demand for agriculture? Minister Guzman, Minister of the Economy in Argentina, was talking about the global economy, where we do see a shock in supply and demand. As you've said in your question, agriculture will be protected from both. As I said before, production has not been greatly affected, except for some perishable products that have special features. The demand worldwide is not falling substantially either. Some sectors have been impacted, but food itself and trade has decreased very little. So that does apply to the global economy, of the shocks and impacts, but it is not so relevant for worldwide agriculture. I'd also like to comment on what Roberto said. I think he brought up very important elements to consider for agriculture. Importing countries, as a consequence of the pandemic, as Roberto said, will try to strengthen their own production and to have their own self-supply. But that has very precise limits. There are some countries that cannot produce. They just don't have the resources, the natural resources to produce. This happens in Latin America, and it also, well, Latin America, for example, some countries of the Caribbean. Some cannot have enough supply for themselves, or they might be self-sufficient, but at great costs. So they end up importing. This would help us find special agreements between the large net importers like China and the large net exporters like Brazil and Argentina, focusing on food safety, on quality, and also environmental points that Roberto mentioned. That means there would be an important increase in trade between the net importers that have to import and us that we are net exporters. Thank you, Martin. Roberto, I'd like to talk about government policy. As you said, agriculture is well organized, and now there's this good valuation in the world, a new status for agriculture in the world that wasn't there before. People have understood and discovered its importance. So, in terms of government, credits, insurance, guarantees of inputs for producers, do you think the models should provide more support for agriculture now? Yes, exactly what I think. Thank you for the question. Agriculture has gained new importance worldwide. Governments will have to pay closer attention. That might mean protectionism or not. Some issues have to be covered by governments. First, logistics and infrastructure. This is a clear issue for governments. They have to work on that. Access to markets through roadways, ports, riverways. Many governments, like Brazil's, do not have the money for that. So that entails agreements, public-private partnerships, so that government can coordinate these matters. Another topic is to ensure food security to their people. How do you do this? Guaranteeing agricultural production. How do you do this? With public policy. For example, enough credit, insurance, minimal market prices, everything that comes together in an economic policy for the countryside. I think Mauro, sometime soon in Brazil and the whole region, at least in the southern cone of Latin America, we will have an economy with three pillars: technology, insurance, and credit. If there's no technology, there's no insurance. If there's no insurance, there's no credit. So they're all closely linked. If we see this happen, we will be very well integrated to a great production scheme. And then we can have guaranteed prices. So those are the roles of government. Infrastructure, policies, connectivity to ensure that, and network policies. Another thing that's essential is the technology. We've mentioned this. In Brazil, we've grown technically a lot, thanks through Embrapa. But we've lost a bit of that momentum we had of technological innovation, and we cannot do that. We have to keep investing in research, and this is also an issue for government. And repeating myself, diplomacy, diplomatic action, trade agreements have to go through government necessarily. The critical issue now of the EU and Mercosur, it's a bit stalled. So we need strong diplomatic action from Mercosur countries, given the resistance that we already envision in Europe regarding topics like deforestation, what happened in the Amazon, and other communication points. So public policy, income for producers, the three P's, three pillars, technology, structure, technology, insurance, credit, and we need diplomatic action to ensure this. These are factors that will probably have to impact government action. So, Martin, based on what Roberto has shared on government policy, do you think that trying to ensure that sustainability and food security will see production focusing more on their own countries? Or will there be a regional production more than we have today? Could you say again, please, the last part, please? Will countries today focus more on their own production internally? Or will there be a more of a regional production and trade between neighboring countries to ensure that sustainability? Well, as I said, it's very low today. It's not, there's not a lot of regional trade because of the logistics problems. So regional integration for food security and agricultural trade, it cannot just be a political decision. It also requires work in developing logistics, communications, and as Roberto said, it also depends a lot on the diplomatic part, the agreements we have for regional trade. The Mercosur-EU agreement, if implemented, we all hope, of course, it does, it would also be a good umbrella to facilitate trade in the region as well. Intra-regional trade and intra-regional agreements under the umbrella of ELADI. So the agreement with the European Union is very important, not just because of the trade we could have with the EU and because it links us to one of the great powers of the world and gives us worldwide presence, but also because it would help us in our regional integration, particularly through agricultural trade. Roberto, in Latin America, we lost a bit along the way of industrialization. We got deviated from that track. So if you look at breakthrough technologies, communications, devices, is not necessarily going at the pace of other countries. So Latin America could have great advantages. We could find ourselves in the forefront of technology for food. because we are a region that is still supplying to large part of the world. So do you think that countries here in Latin America and in the South specifically, do you see us being part of that forefront in technology and production at the leading the way? Thank you, Mauro. Thanks for that question. I believe we can. Yes. And what you asked before applies here again about cooperation, technological cooperation in the region. If we achieve that, of course, yes, it will happen. We will be at the forefront. But we can also say that the progress the region achieves has to be through agro-industry. So even if we are not worldwide leaders in chips and computers, we can be leaders in food security. And for that, it is absolutely essential to have real coordination in the region. There's a bit of more of a romantic idea than reality. In Mercosur, for example, we don't even have agreement with macroeconomic issues in terms of interest rates, currency. Everyone has their own economy and their own financial issues without a clear integration amongst the group. We don't have integration among the sectors either, or from agriculture in Brazil to Uruguay to Argentina. Everyone has their own price policies, credit and savings policies, a different way of looking at agriculture and how the sector evolves. So we cannot have more profound economic integration if we don't fix these matters first. These should be structured very specifically to begin with. And then we will have another policy coming after that. For example, take Brazil and Argentina. We export soy and corn to China. What we want is to export soy and corn through other cheeses and other things that go to China and others. So that means adding value to other products with that. So we want to do that here in our countries first, adding value here. But China wants to do it over there in their country, adding value over there to create jobs and income in their country. And we're both right. We both want the same thing. So how can we come to an agreement? Well, we have to understand each other first amongst ourselves, and then we can find a diplomatic agreement with China or with whatever other countries want to have an agreement with us. So we have much stronger agri-industry regionally. I remember Martín Piñeiro, when he was director general of ICA 30 years ago, when we started talking about Mercosur. We had meetings under Martín Piñeiro from AICA in Brazil and Argentina, and we were trying to find national trading between Brazil and Argentina to come together and export together, not competing against each other. We never achieved that. We never managed to do that. So integration amongst ourselves has to be much clearer, more solidary, and not so solitary as we've done it today. But it's a very important question, and the answer is yes, we can. We can be leaders in agribusiness, and this can mean that we will have a worldwide leading position for that. Thank you, Mr. Rodriguez. Based on this response, saying that yes, we can be at the forefront of agricultural technology, what do you think, Martin, is the most important role for this to happen? is it more important to have government working or the private sector trying to open up the paths that lead to that type of technologies and leading the way? I agree with Roberto. There's great capacity for agro-industrial production in our countries. It's very important to work together and to find a way to have greater presence internationally because we have the power to become leaders in the agri-industry. We can become number one in the world, there's no doubt. There is a great responsibility and an important role for the private sector, but government, the state, is also essential. Public policy is important. Governments should give a context of security. They should develop infrastructure and promote public policy, such as Roberto said, credits, insurance, technologies, innovation. The private sector cannot do it alone. It needs government. But government should also give space to private sector to work. So it is a matter of that public-private partnership. It is only together that we will be able to develop the agro-industrial sector as we wish and to become the leaders in that sector. Thank you, Roberto. About that relationship, Brazil, China, Argentina, China. You said that we have to sell not just the soy and corn that they're using, but it's not easy in this modern world where everyone tries to defend their own interests and their own job creation. These will probably be difficult negotiations for the new type of bilateral or multilateral agreements. Yes, of course, because there's great interests behind any of these. If you think about it, in the year 2000, agribusiness in Brazil exported $20 billion to the world. 20 billion. That was in 2000. Last year, 19 years later, 96 billion, so that's five times more. But in 2000, China was 2.7% of our exports. Last year, it was 34%. So we grew in volume and share. So, of course, it is a country with great demand. And then you have China, no, but not only that, you have Malaysia, Indonesia, Thailand, India, Africa. The Middle Eastern countries, so many countries demanding food. So, of course, they all want the best for each. And they all want to add value in their countries because, again, this creates jobs and means income for their countries. We want the same. So, it's just a matter of negotiating. Of course, it is difficult, but it is possible. It's possible because we can match the interests of different countries and make them compatible. To add a bit to what I've said before regarding the public-private partnerships as well and how to work on that, I'd like to mention agricultural cooperatives. In Brazil, we have many, and all of Mercosur's countries, they have an important role. In Brazil, 50% of agricultural production is in the hands of cooperatives. 50%. 80% of members of cooperatives are small producers that would not have any other alternative to be part of worldwide trade if they did not do it through a cooperative. So, the role of cooperatives is more and more important to allow small producers to participate in the market through cooperatives. and credit cooperatives as well. These are becoming more and more important as governments lose capacity to provide for the demand that they have for credit, and private banks don't want to run the risks in these times of pandemic. So savings unions or savings cooperatives are growing, and these are important elements for negotiation with governments. What is different from a developed country and a developing country is how society is organized. A well-organized society is a developed country. If you are disorganized as society, you are not developed as a country. And cooperatives are the economic side of an organized society. So these are very important for governments in terms of production and international negotiation as well. So I have two questions to close, if you allow me, Mr. Rodriguez. First, it's precisely that, as we've heard, how can we ensure that small producers get that technology? How do we ensure that they're connected? If today we have that difficulty to reaching even the larger producers, that's a very important question. The other day I was talking in a very important agricultural fair in Brazil. We had some manufacturers of harvesting machines that could harvest 60 hectares of soy per day. And I said, why would I want a machine like that if I have 50 or 30 hectares? It's no good for anyone. So he said, well, yes, it is for large producers. So then I asked, and he had everything with computers and everything connected and antennae and breakthrough technology. And I said, well, there's some regions in Brazil in the agricultural frontier where you don't have a connection. So how would you do that? He said, well, we have this technological package available. We sell the tractors, the machines, and the antennae so that we can ensure there's connection. And for the tractors and machines to work, because if not, they won't work. So the same question that you're asking now came to my mind. You have 50,000 hectares, you have your antennae and your tractors, but if you have 15 hectares or 20, what will you do? And again, the manufacturer answered, when those technologies are fully implemented with antennae and machines, everything working digitally, the cost of production would be reduced by 10%. Well, 10%, that's the average for all agriculture. So it will double income for those who have technology. Those who don't have technology will see no income because the market will pay the average of production costs. So what happens to smaller producers if they don't have access to this and type of innovation? They won't be able to compete with large producers. And that's the new role for cooperatives and for agricultural cooperatives. They'll have to get the antennae to ensure that all their members are connected, and they probably will have to find collective harvesting mechanisms where the cooperative owns the tractors or harvesting machines to have it used by their members, of course, in an organized manner and well-planned so that everyone has their time of use. So it's a new role for cooperatives, technological innovation with connectivity, digitalization, and satellite agreements. So cooperatives are required to have a new kind of participation at that level, technologically speaking, not just for fertilizer, seeds, inputs, pesticides. They will also have to participate in connectivity, antennae, for digitalization to work. If not, small producers are out. So a last question, same one for both. Considering what we've spoken and what you've spoken about, in the near future, not looking in the longer term, but in the near future, in looking at what we have today in agriculture, there's already some changes. Food distribution is changing. We have some producers in Brazil that are directly bringing their merchandise to the shops. So, will it be different from today, the near future? If you could both answer the same question. Of course, we will have changes. And then, of course, that means we will have differences in the rural sectors. We've already mentioned this. Agricultural management will change. In a few years, a farmer in their farm, at home, or even in the city, in the morning, will log into the computer and know the temperature of the soil, air, humidity, the wind direction. And so they'll be able to decide right then and there in their computer without going out to the field whether or not they should change things, provide some pesticide or other types of phytosanitary treatments. And then he'll press a button and a drone will exit the office with the pesticide and apply it on the region he has defined. We'll have profound technological changes in how things are managed. There's no doubt. And I believe again that cooperatives will be a dominant topic. Also, if we look at distribution chains, they will see great changes as well. It's already happening, actually. There's already frequent talks about drones bringing supplies to consumers' homes with orders that have been done digitally, that have been placed digitally. So many changes. But again, this will all have to be closely analyzed, and it has to go through two fundamental questions. First, looking at the regulatory environment. What will the legal structure look like to ensure these things can happen appropriately with institutions that will also change? Our institutions will change. Our communications and marketing will look different. So the regulatory frameworks will also have to innovate. So that things are applied adequately. And the second point is agro-industry. If we talk about beef, for example, or meats, poultry, pork, different producers, even dairy, will have to be related differently to their industry, either through cooperative or in a more capitalistic way. And this will also require new regulation in terms of water consumption, preservation or technologies, inputs used to breed animals, to feed them. So the whole industrial process also in terms of health. All these are regulatory matters that governments will have to look at closely. So there's no doubt that things will be different. There will be profound changes that will directly impact on income of producers and income for countries. We all will have to find a way to truly participate from exports. I have absolutely no doubt that our countries in Mercosur will play a fundamental role in worldwide supply of food, energy, and fiber, and even biofuel. It is becoming a more and more important situation, even with the bad prices of oil now. These changes will come, they're profound, and they will ensure better conditions of sustainability for production and for food safety as well. So regulatory environment and integrating chains, agreements to integrate chains, will be an essential part of the future. Thank you, Rodriguez. Martin, how do you see agriculture in the coming years? Roberto, thank you very much for your participation. I'd like to add something. Yes. Some points I'd like to add. In terms of technology, there is a subtopic there, and it's a key issue, which is fertilizers. We'll have to find organic fertilizers, organo-mineral fertilizers. In the case of Brazil, we export almost 80% of what we produce, so we need to find alternatives, composites, and the types of things that are already being used in many farms even here. It's crucially important. And also the biological handling of pests and diseases. We have to advance a lot in terms of scientific research there. Research should focus on biological controls. Sustainability depends a lot on these matters. And something else we haven't mentioned yet, and it's under the regulatory frameworks, contracts, whether they're national and between producers and industry, input producers and farmers, imports and exports. All the regulatory frameworks should require strict contracts, so that laws are actually enforced and are satisfactorily met by all, so that we also have political security post-pandemic for the near future. Thank you. Thank you. We're coming to a close in our conversation. Thank you very much, Mr. Roberto Rodriguez, Mr. Martin Pinheiro. You can have your closing remarks, Roberto, if you want to have another minute. Well, I'm a friend of AICA for decades now. I've worked with AICA for decades. I've had the opportunity to be close to the Institute through the OCB, the Brazilian Rural Cooperatives. And so I've had quite a lot of contact, and I really appreciate the work done by AICA. I would like to always be available for AICA to make use of me in my old age so that I might be useful to you. So thank you so much for inviting me. These types of conversations are very interesting and should be held internationally so that every country can learn from experiences in other countries. Thank you so much, Mauro. Thank you, AICA, my dear friend. Director General Manuel Otero and Francisco, everyone, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Rodriguez. I would also like to thank AICA. These types of discussions are very important, and it's important to continually look for contact to ensure that we can learn from others, to see what new experiences we have, to find new ways to ensure agricultural cooperation within our continent and the countries that make it. We are all great producers, agricultural producers, so it's very important to keep searching for ways to come together. Thank you, Mr. Martin Pinheiro, as well. And we will see you on another occasion. So, coming to a close with our meeting, could you share your views, Martin, of agriculture in the future? How do you see it in the coming years? Agriculture will transform into agri-industry. Agri-industry will be more similar to other industries, increasingly so. That transformation will come through three large trends that already were before the pandemic and will just be accentuated. The first one is digitalization and information technology applied to agriculture. The pandemic has seen us all using Zoom and our cell phones much more than before. This will happen in agriculture as well. Farmers, as Roberto said at some point, will have technology through digital means. The second is the bigger concern for food safety and health overall. This pandemic will, again, increase that focus. And the third is changes in consumption. Less meat, less dairy, more fresh products. These three trends will be the large transformation aspects of agriculture, how agriculture will change as we see it today to a very complex, different agro-industrial sector. For that, governments will have to work with the private sector. They should provide adequate public policy for that to happen. Thank you so much, Martin. And now for your closing remarks for our encounter and the sessions that AICA is organizing. To discuss any potential issues and food security. Yes, thank you, Mauro. Closing thoughts. Well, all of us that are working in the agro-industrial sector, and AICA particularly, have two big challenges. One is, how do we convince and help governments in recognizing agriculture and agri-industry as a large productive sector in the economy? How can we ensure they give it the importance it deserves and it needs for our countries to transform themselves, to grow and develop and become large leaders of the agri-industry in the world? The second challenge is, how can we ensure that Brazil and Argentina, both their governments and their private sector, come together and find a way to dialogue, to collaborate, share experiences and coordinate their action in the development of the agro-industrial sector? Those two things together would also lead to a stronger regional integration. AICA has an important role to play there, and all of us also have our part in these challenges. Thank you, Martin, for your closing thoughts. With that, we can close our encounter discussing issues facing Latin American countries and in the southern part of the region. Thank you.